grace, peace, and mercy, just one very brief note for this service, just to make things a little simpler for everybody. If you turn to the page in your bulletin that has the song, Were You There? Just dovetail the bulletin, because we'll be singing that song five times. So we'll be singing a verse of that song five different times. So have that at the ready. So this will be a tenebrae service. This is a service of light. So you will notice that there'll be changes in mood, there'll be changes in candles. It's very meditative. I hope and pray that it's a blessing to you all.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.
By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us.
Let your ways be known upon the earth, your saving health among all nations.
Let all the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
Have mercy on us.
I planted you as my fairest vine, but you have brought forth bitter fruit. I made you branches of the vine and never left your side, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I poured out saving water from the rock, but you gave me vinegar to drink. I poured out my life and gave you the new covenant in my blood, but you prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
But you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
O my people, O my church, what more could I have done for you? Answer me. I lifted you up to the heights, but you lifted me high on the cross. I raised you from death and prepared for you the tree of life, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
I grafted you into my people Israel, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
I gave to you in the least of your brothers and sisters, but I was hungry and you gave me no food, thirsty and you gave me no drink, a stranger and you did not welcome me, naked and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison and you did not visit me, and you prepared a cross for your Savior.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
So Judas brought a band of soldiers along with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Who are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus stated, "I am." Judas, his betrayer, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Jesus repeated his question, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." "I told you," Jesus answered, "I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." He said this to fulfill the words that he spoke, "And did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter had a sword. He drew it, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his right ear. servant's name was Malchus. Put your sword back into its sheath, Jesus said to Peter. Do you imagine I am not going to drink the cup my Father has given me? Let us pray, brothers and sisters, for the Holy Church of God throughout the world, that God, the Almighty Father, guide it and gather it together, so that we may worship him in peace and tranquility. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. Guide the work of the Church. Help it to preserve in faith, proclaim your name, and bring salvation to people everywhere. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. The other disciple was known to the high priest. He went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter stood outside the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman at the gate spoke to Peter. You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you? He replied, I am not. It was cold. The slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire. They were standing around it, warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. I have spoken openly to the world, was Jesus' reply. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple, where all the Judeans come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why are you asking me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said. When Jesus said this, one of the police standing nearby slapped him on the face, saying, is this how you answer the high priest? If I have spoken wrongly, Jesus answered, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me? Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, you are not also one of the disciples, are you? He denied it, saying, no, I am not. One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, spoke up. Did I not see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it, and instantly the cock crowed. Let us pray for our brothers and sisters who share our faith in Jesus Christ, that God may gather and keep together in one church all those who know Christ, our Lord. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church its unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. We are all consecrated to you by our baptism. Make us one in the fullness of faith, and keep us one in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Where the governor was stationed. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the praetorium because they were anxious not to become ritually unclean and unable to eat the Passover meal. So Pilate went outside to ask, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" "If he wasn't wicked," they replied, "we wouldn't be handing him over to you." "Then take him yourselves and judge him by your law," Pilate replied to them. "We are not allowed to put anyone to death," the religious leaders replied. This was so that the word of Jesus might come true, and it indicated what sort of death he was going to die. So Pilate re-entered the praetorium, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Was it your idea to ask that?" Jesus responded. "Or did others tell you about me?" "I am not a Jew, am I?" Pilate replied. "Your own people, or the chief priests, have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Judeans. Clearly, my kingdom is not that sort of kingdom." "So," Pilate said, "you are the king." Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." "What is truth?" Pilate asked him. With those words, he went back out to the crowd who had gathered and told them, "You have no case. He is not guilty. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" "Not this man," they shouted and replied. "No, give us Barabbas." Barabbas was an insurgent. Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God, that they may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. Almighty and eternal God, long ago, you gave your promise to Abraham and his prosperity. Hear the prayers of the church that people who first made your home may arrive with us at the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Praetorium. There he took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers wove a crown of thorns, put it on his head, and dressed him up in a purple robe. They would approach him, announcing, "Hail, King of the Jews," and then strike him on the face. Pilate went out yet again. "Look," he said, "I am bringing him out to you so that you will know that I still find no case against him. He's without guilt." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. "Behold," Pilate said to them, "here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt." They answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he claimed to be the Son of God." Let us pray for those who do not believe in God, that they might find him who is the author and the goal of our existence. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all might long to know you and have peace in you. Grant that, in spite of the hurtful things that stand in their way, they may all recognize in the lives of Christians the tokens of your love and mercy, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God and Father. Amen.
Amen. Tried to release him, but the crowd cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out, and he sat on the judge's bench, a bench called the stone pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was about noon on the day of preparation of Passover. "Look," said Pilate, "here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified, and they took Jesus away. Let us pray for those who serve in public office, that God may guide their minds and hearts, so that all of us may live in true peace and freedom. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, watch over those in authority, so that people everywhere may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had a notice written and put on the cross, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many Judeans read this notice because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am King of the Jews.'" "What I have written, I have written," Pilate answered. Let us pray that God, the Almighty and Merciful Father, may heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and rid the world of falsehood, hunger, and disease. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic, which was made of a single piece of cloth. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it, but dice for it, to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they decided the dice." And that is what the soldiers did. Behold, the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.
Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and beside her the disciple whom he loved. "Mother," he said to her, "here is your son." Then he spoke to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that hour, the disciples welcomed Mary into his own house. After this, when Jesus knew that all was completed, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing nearby, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. Jesus drank it and then said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Behold, the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.
It was the day of preparation. The coming Sabbath was an especially solemn and sensitive one, so the Judeans did not want the bodies left on the cross during that time. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. The soldiers came and broke the legs of the men who were crucified with Jesus, first the one, then the other. When they came to Jesus and saw he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers thrust a spear into his side, and at once blood and water came out. "You who saw this has testified truthfully. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, so that you too may believe." These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of the scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After all this, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the religious authorities. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, came too. He brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. Then they took Jesus' body and wrapped it with spiced cloth, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been buried. So because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Behold, the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.